always had a strong interest in other parts of the world, other periods of time. In college, I studied archaeology and folklore and mythology. And so from childhood, my interest has been in the kind of things that you see in fantasy. And got started, I decided that I wanted to be a writer when I was about 9 years old and didn't get serious about it until college, but really never looked back. So in this one, she goes to Akia, which is a country that's very much based on the Middle East, the Arabian Desert, that kind of region. And it involves kind of two new things for her. One is that she is asked to try to breed dragons in captivity, which turns out to be more than a little bit difficult. And the other is that there's much more archaeology in this book because there are ancient ruins in the desert that end up having quite a lot to do with the story. It helped that the previous series that I had written, which is now starting to be published in French, The Onyx Court, each of those books takes place in a different century, and they kind of move forward through time. So the third and fourth books are in the 18th and 19th centuries, which meant that when I started writing the memoirs, I had been in the Victorian period in England with the previous book. So I had done a lot of research reading for that and had the voice and the feel of the time period very, very clear in my mind already. You did actually have a surprisingly large number of women who were historians, linguists, scientists, travelers, adventurers, doing all manner of things that you don't see a lot of in fiction, or rather, when you do see them in stories, it's presented as, oh, this was this once-in-a-lifetime exception. Only the more you look around, the more you find that there were dozens of them, not just one. So it was very much those kinds of women that I was modeling her on, and even after I started writing the series, I kept on finding more and more examples and thinking, wow, it looks like I based her on this person, but I didn't even know about them until later. The idea of doing it in the first place actually came from my agent, because it was already a thing in the story that Isabella, did some art as a young woman, because that's the kind of genteel activity that young women were allowed to do. And Tor, my publisher, thought that would add a lot of visual interest to the books. So we were very lucky that Todd Lockwood, the same artist who does the covers and whose art actually helped inspire the series for me in the first place. He then did the covers, he does the interior sketches. And so what I would do is pick out 10 things in each book that seemed like they were a good idea for an illustration, trying to space them kind of equally through the story. And then I would send him detailed descriptions of things. Sometimes I got to see preliminary sketches, and we worked it up to the finished product. And I think it adds a lot to the feeling of the book, because it's a very Victorian thing to do, of having these panel illustrations. I like having them in there. But I liked the fact that since each book is a different expedition, it means that I get to send her to different parts of the world and not be trapped entirely in that one culture. It's still basically an English woman encountering these other cultures, but she goes to places based on Romania and West and Central Africa, Polynesia, the Himalayas, etc. So I get to kind of branch out more. Next year, next spring, I will be publishing a standalone sequel to the memoirs of Lady Trent, which has to do with her granddaughter, Audrey, and the translation of a lost mythological epic from the ancient Draconian civilization that features in the memoirs. So that one is much more about language and archaeology and kind of intrigue at home.